Segregation, the policy or practice of separating people of different races, classes, or ethnic groups, as in schools, housing, and public or commercial facilities, especially as a form of discrimination. Segregation started in the early 1800s when blacks were used as slaves in the South. The slaves were bought and sold as though a white man could tell them how to live their lives. When slavery was abolished after the Civil War in 1865, the freed blacks suffered much. Their lack of education stopped them from getting good jobs to provide for their families. Even though the new laws prohibited racial segregation, white people held on to this as though it was a part of their culture. 89 years later, in 1954, the U.S. Supreme Court declared that segregated schools were unconstitutional, and they wanted desegregation. When the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, or the NAACP, saw this, they tried to enlist as many black students in all-white schools as they could. The Little Rock, Arkansas School Board agreed to desegregate their schools. They decided that desegregation would start in September 1957 at the all-white Little Rock Central High, and that would only be 10th, 11th, and 12th grades. Daisy Bates, the president of the NAACP, would have 9 students enrolled at that school by that summer. Out of the 9, only one was a senior. His name was Ernest Green. 6 of the other students were juniors: Minnijean Brown, Terrence Roberts, Elizabeth Eckford, Thelma Mothershed, Gloria Ray, and Melba Pattillo. The other 2 were sophomores, Jefferson Thomas and Carlotta Walls. All of them were great students, hardworking and well-behaved, but they knew they would not be able to join clubs or teams. Ernest would not be able to play his tenor saxophone in the band. Jeff could not join the track team, and Minnijean could not sing in the glee club. The black students would only be able to go to school, but that would be an accomplishment, Ernest Green said. 11 days before school started, Governor Marvin Griffin from Georgia spoke at a dinner in Little Rock. He said that Arkansas should resist integration like Georgia had. An audience of 300 cheered. Before school started, Daisy Bates prepared the 9 for some of what they might encounter. She told them to ignore racial slurs and avoid confrontations. She tried to give confidence to the students who were about to make history. On April 27th, the Mothers League, a white segregationist group, filed a lawsuit to get an injunction or legal order to prevent desegregation. At the public hearing, Governor Faubus showed up as a surprise witness. He said that he had been told that there were white and black teens buying guns and knives and planning on a fight. The injunction was granted. In the next few days before school, an 8-foot cross burned in Daisy Bates' lawn. It said, "Go back to Africa, sign the KKK." September 2nd, the day before school started, a reporter knocked at Daisy Bates' door and asked her if she knew that the National Guard was all around Central High. That same day, Governor Faubus said that the National Guard was only there to maintain peace. Confronted by the NAACP, the U.S. court judge said that integration would start on September 4th. Daisy called the police department and asked them if they could have a police escort. She called the students to tell them to meet her a few blocks away from the school. She got a hold of everyone but the Eckfords. That morning, Elizabeth Eckford walked to the bus stop in her brand new black and white dress that she made for her first day at Central. When she got off the bus, she saw the mob and hurried toward the school entrance. Once she got to the line of soldiers, they raised their rifles to her face, but she held her head up high and looked for an opening. Once she could not find one, she turned away, trying her hardest not to cry. Elizabeth sat on a bench and looked straight ahead. When the other 8 got to school, they were turned away also by the soldiers. For the next several weeks, the 9 met at Daisy's house to do their homework that she got from their teachers. Late Sunday night on September 22nd, Daisy got word that the governor was ordered to remove the troops, and the police went to her house to discuss the protection of the 9 students as they would enter the school the next day. Monday morning came and Daisy wondered, would this really be the first day for the kids' school year? At the school, a crowd was forming, and by 8:30 a.m., there was more than 1,000 people. A voice in the crowd yelled, "Here they come!" but they had mistaken. It was only four black reporters. They thought that the reporters were the parents of the nine, and the mob went after them, throwing bricks, and one man was doubled over in pain as a white man kept kicking him in the stomach. While the mob was paying attention to the journalist, the nine black students hurried through the side doors. After a while, the crowd realized what had happened. They all hurried inside. By noon, the students had to leave for their own protection. The mayor sent a telegram to President Eisenhower saying, "The situation is out of control. Please send help right away." The president took the Arkansas National Guard away from the government and placed them under federal order. This time, they would help integration, not stop it. Also, he sent the 101st Airborne Division to Little Rock. The 101st Division secured the entrances when they got to Central. After all the president did, Daisy was informed that the nine would go to school the next day. At 8:25, the nine were waiting at Daisy's house for their military escort. When the military came, they knocked on the door and said, "Mrs. Bates, we are ready for the children." Almost one-third of the white students weren't at school, either to protest against desegregation or for their own safety. Once the nine got to school, they were escorted by the Arkansas National Guard, the same soldiers that a few weeks before tried to keep them out of school. But this time, they went through the front doors. Most of the students accept the blacks' presence. Some even invited them to sit with them at lunch. When the bell rang at 3 o'clock p.m., the nine left out of the side door, surrounded by paratroopers. The next weeks at Central were good but stressful for the nine. They got yelled at, and some people even threw rocks at them. Many threats were made at the school, but only a few were actually true bombs. Minnijean Brown seemed to be singled out for torment. After months of being pushed, spit on, and called names, she dumped a bowl of chili on two of the white boys and was suspended for a few days. But in February 1958, she insulted a white girl who had been calling her names. She was expelled. During that time, students passed around cards saying, "One down, eight to go." But out of all of these tragic things, on May 27, 1958, Ernest Green was the first black student to graduate from Central. 10 years later, Little Rock still slowly desegregated, and 68% of Southern black children were still in segregated schools. Daisy Bates said, "The courts can't change how white people think about blacks. They have to change themselves." If it weren't for the Little Rock Nine and what they went through, we wouldn't have the freedom to choose our friends or who we talk to today. So thank you, Little Rock Nine.